Ever since Zuma's rape trial, you have had a glorification of the gun. This is referred to as liberation heritage. It's problematic. Explain to young boys that there are alternative models of manhood.
In 1994, Raymond Suttner was elected to Parliament and became chair of the Foreign Affairs Committee. In 1997, he was sent as an ambassador to Sweden, where he remained until 2001. Thereafter, he did not return to active politics, but, while remaining engaged, concentrated on research and writing. Raymond, thinking back to the 1955 Congress of the People when the Freedom Charter was adopted, the ANC-led alliance of organizations began advancing a non-racial perspective. How did this perspective come to dominate ANC politics of the time?
The ANC gradually developed from an organization who conceived unity of the oppressed in an ever broader way. First, African men only, but uniting what had been separate chiefdoms. Then it came to include women. And then in this period, although the ANC as an organization was separate, it formed alliances with Indians, coloreds, whites, and women and trade unions. There had still been residual tensions with Indians, as had broken out in 1949, and with the communists prior to their banning. In fact, communists were to play quite a prominent role in the Congress Alliance, as it was called, although they were doing so de facto, because the Communist Party was underground. So the Freedom Charter begins with words which Africanists and black consciousness people find objectionable. South Africa belongs to all who live in it, black and white. So it enunciates a vision of a society where the position that you hold, the rights that you have, will not depend on what population group you belong to. The word race, by the way, is unscientific, but you can't ignore the word race because rights were allocated, advantages were given to people, disadvantages were suffered by people on the basis of being socially constructed as Africans, coloreds, Indians, and so forth. Now, the ANC and its allies in the Freedom Charter went all over the country to hear what people wanted. And if you look at that document, it's not the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It's a South African document. It is a reaction. The freedoms it calls for may be unnecessary to call for in other countries. But in South Africa, it called for freedoms which related to what people suffered under apartheid repression.
What is the relevance of affirmative action and black economic empowerment now? And is there a contradiction between these policies and the post-1994 idea of non-racialism?
Affirmative action is an attempt to deal with historical disabilities which are undeniable, which are attached to the social categories of race. And it measures whether people are advancing in professions, in universities, in a number of other places. It's based on, it derives from America where it applied to minority. Here it applies to the majority. And I think it's very important that we don't deny the significance of this. But it's not enough to put people, it's the same with women, to put women and to put black people in top positions. You have to transform the culture of those institutions. The universities in South Africa are still primarily white institutions with curricula which are not transformed in a way which changes the paradigms in that they are derived either from the apartheid era or from purely from the West, or mainly from the West. Also, I believe if you promote someone to a position, you set them up for failure unless they have had a proper mentoring process. Now, I think that the supervision and on a one-to-one basis is inadequate, that many people, especially black people, are not getting adequate supervision which talks to them, which recognizes the sensitivity of coming from a Bantu education, disadvantaged black background. With regard to black economic empowerment, it means that it's depicted in various ways, you know, as transformative and all of this. I think what it does in reality is transform the capitalist sector to some extent and allows entry or allows the emergence of a very small black capitalist, especially African capitalist class, and it does very little for everyone else. However, I do think it is legitimate to create a black capitalist class, but I believe that the government should apply incentives and disincentives, not only to the black emerging bourgeoisie, but to all of the capitalist class. For example, tax breaks if you create more jobs, tax disincentives if your work is capital intensive and is in the financial sector only. And they haven't done this. And you have heard things that there's nothing wrong with being filthy rich, or I didn't enter the struggle to become poor. And I think that black economic empowerment has created some resentment, and government has not used its stick and carrot in order to direct it adequately towards productive activities and job-creating activities.
How do you align the idea of non-racialism with these policies?
Non-racialism is meaningless if it ignores the existence of different locations of different sections of the population group. Non-racialism doesn't make race disappear. It doesn't become irrelevant that I am white and never carried a pass. It doesn't become irrelevant. This is where I disagree with Neville Alexander of UCT, who says, you know, race, you can't have non-racialism and mention the word race. I think you will make non-racialism irrelevant if it erases the disadvantages left by apartheid. Affirmative action attempts to address the disadvantages that black people still have because they have been black, and because de facto there is discrimination in the marketplace.
Now, this year there's been a lot of what is referred to as playing of the race card by politicians. Is race overemphasized?
So-called race card is used selectively. When someone wants to investigate corruption, they respond by saying people are trying to show that black people are incapable of governing, and that is misuse of it. And I think it is very, very important that our country should be represented in a way that is demographically representative of the character of the country. It is correct that we should have primarily African leadership, but that is a different question from how you relate to others.
Next time we will discuss the state of the nation going forward on Reflections with Raymond Suttner.
I don't think the ANC was very well prepared for undertaking government. Forces of resistance were not able to defeat the enemy or the apartheid regime. Zuma brings the power of office and the power of wealth. Some of it may well be ill-gotten wealth,